let everyone that is to mirth inclined come draw near, I pray, and listen a while. 'Tis witty and pretty, diverting and new, and though it is merry, it's certainly true. In the city of London there lately did dwell a topping wine merchant that's known very well. He had but one daughter, a beauty most bright, who was all his comfort and all his delight. A handsome young vintner, he lived very near, who dealt with this merchant for thousands a year, and being invited to supper one night, he happened to see this beauty so bright. Oh, instead of his stomach, he feasted his eyes on the charms of her beauty, which him did surprise. But that very night, fortune proved kind, that he to the lady discovered his mind. Young Cupid so cunningly acted his part, that with the same passion he wounded her heart. So that when he began to discover his mind, he found that to love she was quickly inclined. Said she, "Sir, I find that your stock is but low, some hundreds of pounds to my father you owe. And I am a lady of noble estate, how dare you pretend to talk at this rate?" "Dear madam," he said, "had I 1,000 a year, I'd part with it all for the sake of my dear. And let not true love be despised for gold, for riches can't buy it, 'tis not to be sold." She granted him love, and to him replied, "My dear, I would have you be well satisfied. Your love be true, my jewel," he said, "a politic fancy I have in my head. And when that you hear it, I doubt not," said he, "but unto the fancy you'll quickly agree. You know in the vault where your father's wine stands, there are some empty casks upon the left hand. The cooper's my friend, I can trust him," said he, "I'll give him 10 guineas of gold for his fee. You shall head up yourself in a hogshead this night. Your father will think it is good Lisbon white, and he'll come and buy it just as it stands, and pay him the money down on his demand." She liked the project, and both were agreed. The cooper was sent for, who came with great speed. He took up the lady without more delay, and into the hogshead he put her straightway. He headed it up, all secure and nice. Then straightway came the vintner up in a trice, and seeing the merchant, said, "Sir, at this time I am in great need of a hogshead of wine." So to the wine cellar they did repair, to taste of the liquor but when they came there, he, knowing the hogshead, did make this reply: "Sir, this for my money, if any I buy." When I was here last, if the truth I may tell, I tasted the liquor and liked it quite well. For the same they agreed, the money was paid, and he turned him around to the merchant and said, "Sir, all in this hogshead I've brought is mine, but only the staves and the hoops, they are thine." "Yes, yes," quoth the merchant, "and I am content." Then straight to the taste of the liquor they went. He then took a pierce, and pierced the same, but not one drop from the hog's head there came. The vintner, he said, "What bargain is this? The devil a drop in the hog's hoof there is." "Nay, nay," said the merchant, "the bargain is good, for you brought the hog's head just here as it stood. For what will be in it, either beer, ale, or wine, you have bought and paid for it, so it shall be thine." They opened the hogshead, the lady came forth, the old man starred and rapped out an oath: "If this be your bargain, and take her," said he, "sure never poor man was bubbled like me." It is but a folly to fly in a rage. I find that youth are too cunning for age. "You bought her, I sold her, you love her," said he, "£3,000 fortune I'll surely give thee." Well, the vintner, he loves her as dear as his life, and it is reported she proved a good wife. He follows his calling of drawing of bar, and by this you may see there is no